to win and know that it's the day now. Early morning, 5 o'clock, still be that long time on their way, yeah. Early morning, mama wakes me up for the market round. The mama, they call me by my name and say, oh, Saji Brown, oh. The mama, they go to Raleigh Tamaki. Just to make me at least have some color, just for me. And my mind try to educate me for the better man like you.
Good afternoon and welcome to Market Day here on LNTV. Market Day is a program on which we bring you major happiness in the Liberian economy. My name is Chap Davis, and coming up on this edition of the program, the Ministry of Finance launches an aid coordination tool as Minister Samuel Tweh stressed the importance of aid to the growth of African economies. Liberian aviation authorities welcome the resumption of flights by Air France, and we look at market research in several of the produce that are making headways on the world market. Keep listening. We'll be right back after this break.
My mama working hard, while me papa going downtown Monrovia. Makideo, 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 Makideo.
Welcome back to the program, and Market Day is the Liberian economy on one platform. Now, in a bid to coordinate donor aid in line with government development priorities, the Minister of Finance on Friday launched the aid management tool referred to as the Liberia Project Dashboard. Also on Friday, the ministry inaugurated the National Aid and NGO Policy of Liberia to ensure NGO-funded projects achieve value for money. Speaking during the launch at the ministerial complex in Congo Town, Finance Minister Samuel Tweh stressed that aid is crucial to African economies.
That the world itself has lost focus on the importance of aid coordination. I think things have been sliding back a bit. So it looks like with new aid policy, we in the country are trying to refocus discussion here, and maybe this can influence a global trend. And so it's a wonderful thing to talk about that. Aid is important for development. As an economist, I'm one of those who I don't attack aid. I think it's misguided to see aid as the enemy of development. I don't do that. The use of aid, the application of aid, the systems that are there to receive aid should be attacked, not aid. So if we're saying, we want to do growth, we want to do more trade, that's fine. That's what economics is about, growing economies, trade. But aid is indispensable for the development of African economies. I can't see how that's going to happen without a big quantum of aid. And I'll give you why I'm saying this. Since 1960, official development assistance in the world has amounted to around $33.5 trillion, excluding military aid. So the data says 60 years now, we've provided $33.5 trillion of aid money to all countries in the world. That is, the donor countries have provided this aid to receiving countries. So the point made by a gentleman over there about, if we perform well, we get more aid. It's a striking point. The share Africa has received is infinitesimal, 3%. Africa has received 3% of 33 trillion. And just by multiplying 33 by 3, it's somewhere near just $1 trillion. A little more than $1 trillion. Out of 33 trillion, $1 trillion in the last 60 years has come to aid. So the question I'm asking now, where has the other money gone? Where has aid been going? If it's not coming to sub-Saharan Africa, where the need is direst, then where is it going? Because I know it's not going to America. I know it's not going to Germany. So Africa has not received the share of aid that it should have received the last 60 years. So we need to address that problem. We need to improve the delivery of aid to attract more aid. So he has a point in that direction. Okay? We need to improve that. We need to coordinate better. We need to do more efficiencies. Okay? So that we attract more aid going forward.
Well, for his part, World Bank country manager to Liberia, Wema Ntsara, endorsed the new policy, adding that it was consultative.
I would like to congratulate the ministry for what is an excellent policy and procedural manual. Some of us have had the privilege of working in many countries. And I have to say, without flattering you, Minister, and your government, this is one of the best that I've seen. I've liked the process. We've liked the process, we've been involved, we provided inputs, and we were able to see that our inputs were incorporated. So the process was not just a university process, but it was a genuine process of consultation. Having said that, obviously, there may be some that along the way may have been left out, but also as the policy itself is being implemented, there will be areas that might need some further fine-tuning. What I would like to suggest is that let's still make this a living document. When time comes for some updates, let us update the policy, let us update the manual. We've seen this and it has worked in many organizations, many countries. So you have version 1.0 and then you can have an updated version 2.0 that takes into account the experiences of implementing the policy.
Wema Ntsara is the country manager of the World Bank in Liberia. Authorities of the Central Bank of Liberia and other financial actors have outlined short and long-term measures to solve the country's liquidity problem. Central Bank Executive Governor Aloysius Talu said the bank is in partnership with the International Monetary Fund is working to print 27.5 billion Liberian dollars in the next 3 years. Speaking during an appearance before the leadership of the House of Representatives, Governor Talu explained that the bank is also engaging relevant partners for a short-term solution to the liquidity problem.
Currently, there are $23 billion in circulation in the Liberian economy. From our research, that we got $23 billion. All right. So the $500 Liberian banknotes represent only 8.7% of the total money in stock. So 91.7% is the same old enhanced and legacy banking services. So when the issue of visibility, all right, we're not seeing visibility because if 8.7% of the new money, all right, of the whole money is the 500, and 91.7% is the old money, obviously the 91.7%, you know, takes precedence. On the so we have infused 50% so far of the four billion. On the remaining portion of the $4 billion, the bank is presently working on modalities to infuse it into the market, but got to infuse it strategically and gradually because the December season coming when we got to pay government payrolls. So we're gonna dump all the money out because when time comes for our people to have the Christmas and for the children about their children close, we gotta get money in the bank. Otherwise, the problem we experiencing now will have been exacerbated when the summer comes around the corner. So based on our strategy, as the bank asks for money, we give them money. But again, everybody wants everything, okay? Needs versus wants, all right? So we gotta ration how much you gave out so as to, within a year, to make sure cover the other period. So you are, so the next question you're gonna ask is that how is this, what is CBR doing to address this issue? The next question is, why are you guys going to address the issue? Because at the right time, now people are really struggling right now, and they don't want to hear all that long-term December thing. Right now, people have, you know, they want to know how, what you can do to solve the problem. All right. So, well, the CBR is working with various stakeholders, like I said, with IMF, USAID, the National Legislature, and other players to identify more viable solutions, which is to print additional banknotes as a matter of urgency. This is the current discussion with IMF. We have developed a currency management strategy with the IMF, which will guide the printing of additional Liberian banknotes for the next 3 years. So now we have a strategy for a 3 years period now. About $27.1 billion will print in 3 years. $27.5 billion in 3 years.
That's Central Bank of Liberia Executive Governor Aloysius Tallo. The Minister of Commerce has commenced its regular tour of major business institutions across the country. Commerce Minister Mawani Biggs led a team of inspectors to tour several businesses, mainly food importers in Monrovia. The tour took the minister and her team to major food importers, including Fuani Brothers, Futa Corporation, and Swat Incorporated. Speaking to reporters following the tour, Minister Dix said the move was intended to ascertain the condition under which commodities are then stored, as well as the quantity available to the market.
I'm satisfied with what I've seen in terms of the facilities that these commodities are housed in, how they're being handled, and that is very important. And also, it's good to know that Liberians are an active part of this process, because with all of the facilities we visited today, the 3, Fuani, UCI, and SWAT, we've seen that they have invested in hiring Liberians. We have from 350 to 500 employees at those various centers. And so it's good to see that they're taking seriously that we need to incorporate Liberians into the process, even though they are importers, but Liberians have to be a part of the process.
And I'm one with seeing saying too much zeal in your operations.
Well, that's what we need. Anytime there's change, there should be something different. There should be a different feeling, a different level of energy that comes to it. And I'm someone that brings energy, and so I want everyone to be a part today. You know, I have ministers with me, deputy ministers, assistant ministers. I have an inspector general. I have staff from our customer service office who process our importation documents. So I wanted them to come out and get a chance to see and feel what happens on the back end of what they do. And so it's, for me, it's an opportunity for us to collaborate. I think everyone needs to be a part of the process, because once you are invested and you feel like you are making, you know, a meaningful contribution, I think people give their all. And so coming out today, you know, I'm glad this will not be my first or my last. You know, everyone says, oh, everyone starts the same way but doesn't end. Well, I can tell you, I have the energy to continue. So I just need to make sure that you all have the energy to.
Well, Air France has resumed flights to Liberia 9 years after the airline suspended its operations to the country. The airline resumed its flight to Liberia with the landing of one of its latest generation of aircraft, the A350, at Kirabos International Airport. At a brief ceremony to mark the event, Air France Vice President for Africa, Henry Hoka, a show of developing the services of the airline in the country.
And I'm very glad to be here in Liberia today to celebrate this new development of Air France. It's a great honor for me to be here, and I want to thank the Liberian President, George Weah, and the authorities who made it possible our new service between our two capital cities. Despite the terrible crisis we are facing, it is a pride for us to keep opening new routes, to keep developing our services between Africa and the rest of the world. The Group Air France KLM has been present in Africa for more than 85 years. Africa is a strategic area for the group. And since the beginning of the COVID crisis, we have maintained our services in almost all countries on the continent, as soon as, of course, we had the approvals of the authorities. As from today, we will operate daily flight by Airbus 350, which represent the promise of an exceptional traveling experience. The Airbus 350 is the last generation innovating aircraft with the best environmental performance, consuming 25% less fuel, equipped with modern travel cabin, latest generation of seats. 324 seats. Made a quick visit with you guys just arriving. 34 in business cabin, 24 in premium economy cabin, 266 in economy cabin. With this aircraft offers more spacious cabin with windows 30% larger, Wi-Fi on board, and lighting light adapted to each flight phase.
Well, for his part, the Director General of the Liberia Civil Aviation Authority, Moses Kwali, said the resumption of flights to Liberia by Air France is something worth celebration.
The return of Air France aircraft to Liberia is welcoming, especially with a state-of-the-art aircraft, Airbus A350-900 series, a 350-seater passenger aircraft spanning fleets is actually something to celebrate tonight. And as such, we want to congratulate the management of Air France and the authority of the Liberia Airport Authority. This represents Liberia's ability not only to compete, but to thrive into the world's most important and challenging economic sector. Moreover, it represents Air France's remarkable success in connecting Africa and connecting Africans with each other. Our aviation industry is showing to the world what's possible in Liberia that the world-class business can progress here, and that Liberia provides a fertile ground for a good business opportunity. Today's event is not only great for Air France and the Rabat International Airport, but also for the government of Liberia and the people of Liberia.
Head of the Liberia Aviation Civil Aviation Authority, Moses Kwali, ending that's our news segment here on this edition of the program Market Day. We are going to take a break. When we come back from the break, we do some discussions here on the program. Keep watching. This is Market Day, the Liberian economy on one platform.
Brown.
Day is the program on which we bring you all of the happiness in the Liberian economy. Jack Davis is my name, and top stories we follow on the program this afternoon. The Minister of Finance launches an aid coordination tool as Minister Samuel to stress the importance of aid to the growth of African economies. Liberian aviation authorities welcome the resumption of flight by Air France. So, like I said, we will be looking at another issue today. We are talking to the CEO of Champ Solutions Market Research Group. He is George Whitaker, and his group has been doing, some research in the market, and he's going to be telling us more about what are those areas that especially farmers can invest into, what are those produce that are currently on the market that, you know, once you invest into them, then you're going to see your market or your the agriculture sector increase or develop in the country. That's what we are going to be talking about on the program this afternoon. Welcome to Market Day. Welcome to LNTV, Josh.
Oh, thank you very much.
Okay, so we are here and we are looking at, you know, some of the work you've been doing. Let me first of all congratulate you for what you've been engaged into, looking at some of the markets, doing a lot of research to let Liberian farmers know, let Liberian business people know what are those areas that they can invest their money and, you know, will get a huge return on their investments. So that's what we are looking at today. But first of all, how has it been through your research activities and all of that?
Well, yeah, oh, we just appreciate God for everything. We've been doing major research when it comes to the market, but we'll be talking on the recent one, like what we have the agriculture and market, in focus the cassava market. So we just conduct a survey, we took a holistic view on the cassava market. Yeah, so we're going to be looking at, talking about first, our first report on the cassava market, and we'll be talking about other markets, where one can invest their money and can get an investment return. Yeah.
But there are so many produce out there, and why you decided to focus this time on cassava?
Yeah, you know, as a market research company, we conduct our survey based on the demand. Because, I mean, the essence of business is to make sales. So one before you venture into any business, you have to look at the business very well. Will this particular business and make profit? Can I make more sales on this particular business? So we conduct our survey based on that. So we saw that we understand that the cassava has a very high demand on the both domestic and international market. Mm. Yeah, that's how we came up with this.
Cassava has a very high demand on both the local and international market. But carry us through some specifics, you know, that you found about cassava, because I'm sure there are several cassava farmers out there, even watching this broadcast right now, and we want to know what have you found and what can they do in order to, you know, match your findings with the work that they do also.
Oh, thank you very much. Looking at the cassava has a high potential. Cassava has a very huge potential.
Okay.
So from cassava, you get a lot of produce, where you have the gari, that we know that we have the jipo, we have the fufu, we have the kaya, you have a starch, from the same cassava, you have biofuels, you have ethanol, you use cassava to produce beer, and so forth. But firstly, let's try to understand the domestic market first, okay, for the benefit of the farmers. Now, over the years, we had an understanding that cassava, we use cassava to produce and gari. Okay, let's just, because generally, yeah, locally, gari is the one that we gari, know of, fufu and all of that.
Yeah.
All right, fine. So, but now, in order for our country, in order for us to start living in a good economy, and you know, and looking at our population, we shouldn't just rely on the domestic consumption. What we're talking about, the fufu and the depot, because yes, Liberia have a very huge market in terms of our size, but in population we are not many. So let's assume you have more than 5,000 farmers that are harvesting cassava, you know, maybe like just every 6 months annually. Then you look at the size of the market. Now, if you have 3,000 to 6,000 farmers producing cassava and making their fufu or gari or whatever, I mean, then who gonna buy it? How many people gonna buy it? You know, so locally, you see that, I mean, there's not much profit. But then now, since we already understand that we have our cassava is very organic, looking at the global market, now, I mean, there should be a shift to the way we are right now. Now, we should find put ourselves in a position where we can start to export. So once we start...
What has been the hold on to exportation of, of our cassava? Let me just ask specifically about cassava. What has been the hold on? We spoke the last time you mentioned that packaging was another hindrance to that, but is there more to that?
Yeah, there are more to that. One, what I've been a hold on first, as you said, is to firstly identify the market. That's the first thing. It's not possible you just keep on producing with all sales. So once you identify the market, I mean, then you know that yes, there's some level of reliance. But another thing you have to understand first is to know the value for that particular product. So getting the value for that particular product, farmers seeing value in cassava, that the cassava thing is not just for gari or whatever. That's another one. So until the people's minds are open, you know, you'll not get too many people there. So you see, firstly, identifying market. Another thing, Liberians, farmers in Liberia have not been seeing farming as a business. That's another thing. So you see, people get into the agriculture sector, into farming, they say, Liberian will have the English, I just play my lay, cassava, and my baya, and, you know, and my children there, for me, my children to eat it. And you know, so it was a subsistence farming, something like they thought they could just sustain themselves. But they didn't know that this thing is beyond, you know, just a family size thing. It's a whole business. It's a whole market. So now, these are things that have been a hindrance. Now, access to finance. One may want to, you know, do an expansion. Let's assume if you get to Bombing, because these are all cassava belts. Bombing, Bon, Cape Man, Nimba, these are all cassava belts. These are the counties you travel to, you get more cassava, you see people growing more cassava. But when you get there, few years back, or even now, it's still happening, you see people have like, they planting cassava on 2-3 acres of land. And 2-3 acres of land, I mean, then you're not ready for the market. And you know, so sometimes it's not like they don't want to expand, but because they don't have the capacity. So you see sometimes a lack of finance have been a key component wherein farmers have not been reaching their goal. Fine. So we have the finance, access to finance, access to the global market. We shouldn't just say market, access to the global market, and you know, training, because sometimes most often they need to go through the proper training. So these are things that have been, you know, hindering them, and even knowing the value for their own thing they've been doing.
Okay. But you know, looking at your research, did it, you know, pinpoint the kind of market or the countries currently that cassava is being exported to, you know, the kinds of countries that probably might be open up to Liberia now to say, okay, this produce from Liberia, especially the cassava, yeah, we are opening up and it can come in.
Yes, China, you understand? China has a very huge market. Now, this cassava we are talking about, they use it for fermentation. And, you know, like for example, like there are some other products, and like a liquid products that ferment. There is no preservation, so they need something like maybe when you ferment, it's spoiled. You understand me? So they need something or substance that suppress that particular content, so it can't get spoiled for preservation. So like liquor, and, you know, like liquor, beer, and, you know, Guinness, all these things. So they use the cassava for fermentation. You understand? So you see that beer factories looking for where they can get what organic cassava. So China has a very huge market. They have a lot of companies into that. Even the medicine, and, you know, all those herbs and all of that. The from the sea cassava leaves, even the leaves, not even just something, even the leaves they use. You understand? So we identify China. So China has a very huge market when it comes to that. Now, but I want us to get something clear here.
Okay.
Now, in terms of cassava production, you have Nigeria, you have Thailand, you have Indonesia, and, you know, I mean, you have a lot of them. They are major producers of cassava. But also, they are still coming to Liberia. They are still trying to negotiate with Liberian farmers. Where in Nigeria could buy from, you know, Liberia and add to and export to their country, and maybe whatsoever transaction they have, they can export. So the market is not just basically on the channel. China have a huge market, but the market just right around us here in Nigeria, and, you know, and all other countries. Because these people too, sometimes they want to buy. For example, you have a contract, maybe you push out a deal of exporting a kind of a, maybe let's just say 70 or 40 feet containers every month. You know that consistency in supply will be the problem. Maybe they have that deal in Nigeria. So the Nigerian company will come back to Liberia and say, okay, that what we do is that we want to be buying from y'all, and we're exporting to Nigeria, and then we can now supply our the end users or whatever. So you see, so the market is on every dimension.
So what has you based on your own research, you identify these challenges faced by the cassava farmers. Now, what is being done at all, maybe on the part of them as cassava farmers, or even on the part of the authority, to help these farmers to get out of what they are involved with, to get out of, to solve these challenges in order to increase their production and in turn start to export?
Now, I mean, there are a lot that have been done, honestly speaking, because, I mean, our new agriculture minister, she's been very, very proactive. And, you know, also we have the cassava sector coordinator, Joseph Morris. And you also have you have the partners, like you have the organizations. You have the FAO, you have the STAPI, you have the IFA. These are all the major projects, and, you know, set up to facilitate these particular initiative. They were in, I think, in recent time. The STAPI awarded six agro-processors, you know, that in the cassava sector contract. I think the contract was $1.something million United States dollars to grow more cassava, wherein they can feel like people from the orphanage homes, the students, and all of that. And these contracts were awarded to them. So these are some major steps, and all of these things happen through the agriculture ministry. You understand? So there are things that they are doing already. In fact, I read, I think, one of the newspapers that they already submitted the first consignment. And, you know, where the money was paid for, you know, they submitted the first consignment. For students, cassava, yes. They have submitted the first one. Now you see that they have access to finance. It's not like before.
So the STAPI, through the Agriculture Ministry, partner with this World Bank and the IFA. When you check here, it's right here. You see? So you have the World Bank, the funding partner, and the IFA. These are the people that sponsor these six agri-processors. Falama Enterprise and the Global Agri.
And all of these people are into cassava.
They are all into cassava.
Okay.
They are all into cassava. And, you know, so to answer your question, that's just that. So it's not like before. Okay. And, you know, it's not like before. There are platforms that are there where, they are highly supported, like Labrin Business Incubator. And, you know, these are all the agri-processors that benefited from this particular project. So that you'll see that, now they can be able to expand their farms.
Okay. Okay, so he is the CEO of Charm Solutions Market Research Group. He is George Whitaker, and he's our guest on this edition of Market Day. And we're talking about several issues, and his group was, involved. His group is the one that is publishing this magazine called Agriculture and Market. In focus is the cassava market, and all of what you need to know about the Liberian cassava market, as it relates to the global market as well, is in this magazine, not for sale, but just for information to guide investors on the cassava, the Liberian cassava market, to ensure that they make smart investment in the sector in Liberia. So I'm sure if you're watching, you have questions, you have comments, you have recommendations, you are going to do that, because we are going to open the lines where you will interact with us on the program this afternoon. But first, let's go for our commodity update. When we come back, then we open the lines while we continue with the discussion on the program. Let's take our commodity update. Market here on the program, and George Whitaker, the CEO of Charm Solutions Market Research Group, is our guest on this edition of the program. Now, I know, like I said, you will like to be a part of the program. You have questions, you have some concerns that you just want to express on the program. You can call us on 0777-835-862. That's one of the numbers that you can call, 0777-835-862. Better still, you can put your call through on 0886-616-580. 0886-616-580. You can also call that number. And like I said earlier, the orange number is 0777-835-862. Call those numbers and you're going to be live here on the program. So Josh, let's look, put our focus a little bit on the magazine, because you've done this work. You have a lot that you invested into it. It's not for sale, but how you intend, to carry out with the magazine? How are you going to, print copies, and where are the areas that you're going to, place these magazines to get people informed about the cassava market?
All right, thank you. We intend placing this magazine in a very strategic locations, since it's not for sale. Like the Agriculture Ministry, the Ministry of Commerce, the Central Bank, the Central Bank, the airport, and maybe some of the airports, and maybe the foreign affairs, and just like that, and in most of these ministries.
I'm sure embassies will be getting their shares.
Thank you. At various embassies. In fact, even the United Nations, the WFP, which is the WFP and all of that, FAO and all of that. Since we are not intending to sell this magazine, it's not for sale. So, but what we are expecting, we need government participation. But hearing, government participation.
Government participation, how?
Where we need funders, wherein maybe the finance ministry, can look at it it can even be sponsored by an individual. This kind of a project that showcase the agriculture sector in Liberia. It could even be sponsored by the agriculture ministry, wherein they can come out and set a budget that, all right, we need 7,000, 10,000 copies on the market. So the markets will be every part. So you can say, okay, these 7 to 10,000 copies, we set aside 10, 15, 20,000 $. Trust me, it's nothing for them. And it's a very low budget when it comes as compared to this particular initiative. Mm-hmm. So we need the government to come and work from wherever, whether maybe someone to maybe sponsor it, that maybe I will do it, maybe one of these ministers. Because honestly speaking, some countries, I don't want to be political, but these are just realities. Some countries ain't just right around us here. There are ministers, there are representatives. These are initiatives they want to take because they want to see the country on the map. Once it comes to agriculture, you are talking about finance. You are talking about increasing workforce. So any of the representatives, honorable senators, and president or ministers who come up to say, okay, I will contribute $2,000. I will contribute $1,000. So if we have 10 people contributing $2,000, it can be enough for us to print at least 5,000 to 6,000 copies. Mm. So at least we can be able to share at least 500 copies in each location of 100 copies. Mm. So that's where we are right now.
Okay. Just let's look a little bit. Let's take our attention a little bit from, cassava, because we know, so much has been said about it already. But what have you found in your research about other products on the are being produced today by farmers across the country? What are those areas that farmers can also tap into, besides the cassava market?
All right, we have the rice market.
Yeah, rice.
Because
sure.
Rice is our staple food. Mm-hmm. And I don't just want to go there, but if we are just calculating how much the government spent on importing rice to Liberia, annually is an error. It's an error. These are things that have been happening over the years. And though this present government they are still putting things in place. And I'm always communicating with the Federation, the president of the Federation for Rice Association, Mohamed Kamara, and all that. And we met on serious occasion. We even did a highlight on rice within the cassava magazine. So we have a highlight on the rice market as well. But it's not a detail, because the magazine is not talking about rice, it's talking about cassava. So, the government, they are playing their part to see it come true, but we need more effort in the rice market. We need more effort, because, you can be consuming, you can have, your major product, and, if there's a shortage, or you're importing it. For how long are we going to be importing? You can be importing for 5, 6, 7, 10 years. So for the government, sir, though they are focusing on it, but they need to concentrate on it more, then you will get farmers who will be in a position to produce more. Mm-hmm. Because you have farmers that have been producing.
But on which scale? At which scale? Well, what we're talking about, the parboiled rice and this kind of parboiled, this rice kind of, these are all just machineries that make the rice how you want it. You understand? So I believe that if we focus on the rice market, focus on the rice, both push more farmers within the rice sector, I mean, you're going to get something good coming out from the rice sector. They will also have the oil palm. I spoke with the oil palm people. We also have a highlight on them here. And, you know, the national oil palm. We look at the oil palm. Oil palm has a very huge, huge demand. With oil palm, you produce a lot. At least we so bless God for J palm and, you know, and few others that are involved with the oil, man. Value addition when it comes to oil, at least they have kind of fresh, they have all of these things like that. You have the soap and all of that. So but the oil palm has a huge potential. So we need to produce more oil palm to export even our soap, because if you add a value on the oil palm, like out there, you have the soap, you have the cream from the oil palm, you know, and all of that, even for consumption, because for the oil palm, you have both consumable and non-consumable items can come from there, yeah. You know, that you can produce from there. So if we start focusing on the oil palm sector as well, I mean, investing money in these are sectors, I'm telling you that they're going to bring huge return on investment. There will also we also looking at the cocoa sector, and you know the cocoa sector. Now we're talking about vegetable. Now if you check it out, vegetable is like it's overlooked on the liberal market, but it makes a lot of money. You understand me? If you get on the market right now, you go ask for one of this small tomato. When they gave you the price, you say what happened? And people still buying it. So you get what I'm saying? Let me just use our Lake Urukwa. People stay buying it. So these are things that we need to push funds in. We need to push funds in. And I think we know our country is like it's harder political more than business. I think that's where the problem coming from. Our country is highly political. So many people have more interest in political affairs than the business side. And it's an error. And these are the platform that they built for us. And now we're seeing that, I mean, it's affecting almost like everything around. What am I saying? The money that politics generate in the country, I need to divert a bit, but if each of our representatives can even donate $1,000 or even $50 or even $10 every month to the agriculture sector. See, we shouldn't be saying I'd be waiting for money coming in for United Nations, IMF and all of these things. It can't happen. You can't continue feeding people for 200-300 years. You're sure. Just feeding them. Sure. These people, they should be able to at least donate $20 to the agriculture sector every month. So if you have these people doing it in 6 years, that money is enough to expand the agriculture sector. So whatever money that coming is just an expansion, and it's just to add up to what already on the platform. So maybe what I'm saying in short is that our urge. Because the people that have money in our country, right, they are the politicians. I urge the politicians in Liberia to focus on the businesses in Liberia. They should focus on the agriculture sector. Because agriculture is like almost like is our key to success. If we overlook the agriculture sector in Liberia, trust me, meaning we don't have no future. Meaning the generation to come, nothing will be, gratifying for them. So we need to focus on agriculture sector, and we have more that we can invest, you know, into. Like we have the pepper. You'll be surprised that ordinary pepper, we importing pepper from small country in the Guinea Ivory Coast. Okay. You understand? which of course we have the organic soil to produce all of these things. Yeah.
All right. So, what will be your next research target? Because I just want to ask you that one before I ask for your parting comment.
All right. We are looking in the rice side. Yes, we look at the rice market. But you know, as I said, based on teamwork, like you see the cassava platform, the cassava magazine. You have from Kari, and we all work on together. If you look at the acknowledgement. Carry even the agriculture ministry, like almost all of the department work on this magazine. We all working on together in terms of information, gathering information. So what am I saying? If we confirm the rice sector, they are waiting and willing to work with us, they're going to be coming up with the rice magazine. So we're looking at the rice between the rice and the palm oil, the oil palm. Yeah, so the next magazine, if we're coming up, then they, will give, if there's a clarity, which one, then we will notify you people.
Okay, so let's get your parting comment because we don't have time now.
Thanks a lot. So my parting comment here, I urge the government to please try to release funding for this agriculture magazine, wherein we can print more copies because we don't want to sell it. It's not everything you sell. If we need to sell this magazine, we're going to have more sales than by now because we have people requesting from the U.S. and everywhere. But we need a little of funding, at least $10,000 to $15,000, to produce at least 6,000 to 7,000 copies. And I also want to appreciate the farmers, and you know, that always trying their best to do carry on more productions. We are still trying to see how best we can push them, but they are also like trying to, you know, in their weak way, push the agriculture sector. So I want to appreciate them.
Okay. Yeah. I'm sure probably we have somebody that wants to contribute. Hello.
Good afternoon.
Yes. Thank welcome.
You. Thank you. I'm Rosemary calling from Sibata. I listened to the interview guest. Well, thank you for his expertise. Now, a few concerns, questions. The magazine there you spoke about, does it include how do we get the, get connected with this, or cassava chain or process? Because what happened right now, the insecurity of producing more, like you said, farmers are producing less. We have like 25 or acres of land already. And we are targeting 50. But if we produce or clear 50 acres of land to produce cassava, that's our target. We have a farming group called Putting Hands Together, Farming Association working in Grand Bassa. And we want to do specifically cassava this farming season. How can we get benefited or part of this program or whatever? Because if we produce, our concern now is what do we sell? What's the market? That's our concern.
Okay, so sorry, thank you for your concern, and I'm sure you're listening, but sorry, we don't have time. But Josh, just announce your number, then I'm sure you can get in contact not only with this caller, but I'm sure others will want to get in contact to ask more questions that probably they were not able to call today to ask. So you can just announce your number to the public.
All right, so my number is 0779-037-352. Let me go over again. 0779-037-352 or 0886-89-2602. But you get me more on the orange. Then our office is located on the 14th Street, maybe in case you try calling and maybe, I don't know. Or on the 14th Street on the land side, the Provident Corporation building. Yeah. Then on the you can link with the cassava sector because they have the cassava sector as well.
Okay.
So but if you call, then we're going to show you the way.
Yeah, show you the way. Thank you. Okay, so on that note, that's how we end this edition of Market Day here on the program. Before we leave, the top stories we follow: the Minister of Finance launches an aid coordination tool as Minister Samuel Tuwa stressed the importance of aid to the growth of African economies. Liberian aviation authorities welcomed the resumption of flights by Air France, and we also spoke to the CEO of Charm Solutions Market Group, he's George Whitaker, as part of our discussion on the program today. On behalf of the entire production team here at the Liberia Broadcasting System, that's our producer Abraham Taylor, and our switcher on this edition of the program, Anthony Ama. My name is Chad Davis, wishing you all the best from Painesville. Till next week, Wednesday, bye bye for now.
Some money has come across the women that know that it's the day now. Early morning, 5 o'clock, the women that long term on their way. Early morning, mama wakes me up for the market round.
men say, oh, Saji Brown, oh. If my man go to rally, Tamaki, every morning, yeah. Just to make me at least have some color, just for me. If my man try to educate me for the